Well, good morning from my living room to yours. We're gathering for church. It's good to see you. I can't really see you, but you know what I mean. It's good to be meeting at the same time, even if we can't be meeting in the same room. Somewhere, something better to come. Something better to come is our new series. Is it referring to our new building, which is progressing really well? We look forward to meeting together again, which will be in the new building the next time we are all together. Is it referring to getting through COVID-19, the restrictions, the isolation? Even more than those things, we saw last week, something better to come is our eternal inheritance that we have in Christ. It is ours now in Christ, and it can be yours as well. So whatever we might be going through, may we look beyond that to that which is so much better. So welcome to you. If you are new, a special welcome to you. So pleased that you have joined with us today. Love to know that you are with us. So why don't you comment or chat, say hi, let us know that you are here. That would be fantastic. Just like it if you like. That would be great. We would love to connect with you as well. May our service today, may God's word really be a great word for us all today. As we get into it, we're about to sing, we're about to go to the Simmons place, but before we do, let me pray. So please join with me. Loving Father, thank you so much for the great God that you are. You are compassionate and gracious. You are slow to anger, abounding in love. And you do not treat us as we deserve. Your mercy, your grace is truly amazing. We confess our sins to you. We ask for your forgiveness. And we do thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he and only he makes it possible for us to know you, to be forgiven. So we just pray this morning we can bring our honor to you and that you will speak your word of truth into our life today. Amen. Let's sing. Let's sing together. We're going to go to the Simmons house.
God's amazing grace for us and his unfailing love. Stronger.
guys. May every day, may we be singing the praises of Jesus for what it is that he has done for us. Well, in just a moment, we're gonna cross over to the Tingles in Thailand. But before we do that, wanna let you know of a few things that are happening in the life of our church. So I don't know if you've driven past the church building lately, but it is coming together really well, both outside and inside. So this Thursday night, as we prepare to move into the building, which we'll be able to do next month. Well, not all of us, but in some form, we'll be able to move in. We've been busy preparing to move in, particularly John Hooten and a number of others, teams, getting things ready. So this Thursday night on Zoom, there's going to be an opportunity for you to hear what's been happening, what still needs to happen, how you might be able to get involved as well. So the details are there this Thursday, 7:30, and we'll send through the Zoom ID this week. But love you to be a part of that. It'll be an opportunity for questions as well and to find out more. Another thing that we have coming up very soon, it's going to start next Monday, and we want to be a people of the Word. We want to read God's Word together. So we're going to start a new Bible reading plan next Monday. Now, we're pretty much in isolation. So we're going to read through Paul's letters. A number of Paul's letters were written when he was in isolation. They were written to young churches, written to people that he wanted to see grow in faith. So I'd love you to join us in this 60-day Bible reading plan as we look at Paul's letters. So the details have been sent out. So check your email for the invite. You can join through that. And if you haven't received that or if that hasn't worked, let me know. There's the email address there, info@stanhopechurch.org.au, if you would like to be part of this reading plan that we'll do all together. And then we can comment on it together. And then the last thing, Christianity Explored. Maybe you've got a friend and you'd like to explore a little bit more who Jesus is and what it means to follow him. So we're going to start this Friday, the 8th of May. Edwin is going to be leading this. So if you're interested, you want to join it, or you've got a question about it, email him. Let us know that you are keen. Or you've got a friend that you want to invite to be a part of that. Get onto that. That would be fantastic. All right. Well, we are going to cross the seas, go across to Thailand now, where one of our mission partners, the Tingles, are. So let me get some volume
here.
All right. Hello, Matt, Alisa, girls, can you hear us?
Hi.
Can you hear us?
And I can hear you as well. Fantastic. So good to see you. Thanks for joining us for our church at home. So good that we can cross over to you. Now, there'll be some people at our church who won't know you, won't have met you before. So do you just want to quickly introduce yourselves? And are we one down there? Is that,
yeah.
Someone's still sleeping?
Yeah, we couldn't wake one up.
That's all right.
Yeah.
So,
all right.
So we've got Lucy, Jemima.
Lucy.
Hi.
Now you in your pajamas?
No, we all got dressed.
Oh, well, done. There's other people with us. They're still in their pajamas, I'm sure.
I know. They can't hide. They can hide behind the camera,
Yeah. Now, 4 years it is. Is that right? That you've now been in Thailand?
Yep.
Now you've
4 years yesterday.
4 years yesterday, okay. So you're in Chiang Mai, but you're not in Chiang Mai right at the moment, are you?
No, we're in Hua Hin at the moment.
All right. Now that's a fair way from Chiang Mai, so you're there because it's a bit the air's cleaner, and because of the coronavirus, you moved a few weeks ago.
Yeah, we just within I guess recommendation with Sim, our Sim leaders in Chiang Mai, just talking over the different risks and with the air pollution being bad at this time in Chiang Mai, as well as the, I guess, risks involved with coronavirus. They felt it was better for us not to be in Chiang Mai. And so we were just praying about the different options at that time, whether that was a good time for us actually to all go back to Australia or whether we should stay here in Thailand. And after, I guess, thinking through just the different possibilities and options, the best option really was to be still here in Thailand but not be in Chiang Mai. So Hua Hin's a town that we're, or small city that we're familiar with, because my sister-in-law is from Hua Hin, and that's where my brother and her were married about 5 years ago now, maybe longer. But we're familiar with it, and there are the facilities around that we would need, but we have the clear air here, and so we can continue with our normal activities at this time.
What's normal now?
Yeah, we can continue those here, but still be in Thailand.
We were just concerned that if we came back to Australia, we didn't know how long we would be stuck there. Just being out of routine and away from home is difficult already in the circumstances. But we didn't want to get back to Australia and then not be able to come back to Thailand. Even if things opened up here, we might not be able to get flights. So we decided it would be better to stay here.
And so do you want to tell us just a little bit about, what is life like in Thailand at the moment, and how have things changed for you these last few weeks?
Yeah, so Thailand in general is probably at a similar lockdown as Australia. So we're allowed to go out still just to get groceries and to go to the doctors. I guess all the shops and everything like that are closed. The only thing that's open are grocery stores, and even in the grocery stores, they've roped up any aisles that aren't selling food. We really haven't seen anyone. We've been down here for about 6 weeks now, and we leave in a week to go back up to Chiang Mai. The storms hit yesterday in Chiang Mai, so they had their big first storm, and our roofs had its first leak in Chiang Mai, we found out yesterday. So hopefully now that rainy season has come, that will clear the smoke in the air. There's been a big bushfire burning out of control about a kilometre from our house, just over the other side of the freeway. So that's made the air really bad for about the last 3 months. So at the moment, the biggest problem here is that there is no stimulus package or anything like that. So millions and millions of people have no food and no way of getting work or income. So we're seeing a lot of people really struggling here. So the church is trying to step up and support people through that. And so there's been opportunities through church, and we're not up there at the moment, but the church has been handing out food packages to people and going around to smaller villages that are really, really struggling, and trying to help them. We've been able to do that same sort of thing here as well with the Burmese community, buying for them and dropping that over there. So it's, I guess it's hard everywhere, but we probably see the poverty here is really evident, especially at this time.
Matt, for your ministry in the centre, so the centre is closed, but you've still got connections there with the students, so you're still able to do that online and help them with their English and continue relationships that you have with them. How's that been at the moment?
Yeah, so we've been able to continue with the classes that we had started before. So I've got a number of classes that I'm still teaching and connecting with those students. It is more difficult online, and especially if the students' English levels are low, it can be, sometimes a bit like pulling teeth, but it can still work, which is good. And we're currently looking at ways for being able to start up some new classes online, which is something we haven't had to do before, because we've had, I guess, a big part of the centre is that it's a relational ministry. It's a place where students can come and drop in, hang out. And so we're really missing that side of the ministry. We can make calls to students. We can send through messages. Over Easter, I was able to send through an explanation of a video explanation of Easter to the students and talked to them about that. It makes me realize why we're here. When I start talking to students about Easter and I say, oh, well, do you know what Easter is? And most students, once I share the story about Jesus and what he has done for us, I say, have you heard that story before? And I say, no, I've never heard that before. And it really hits me at that those times when I share this message with students, and they just have no idea. They haven't heard the gospel message. They don't know those key stories that I guess in a lot of ways we would assume most people would know these stories, probably in Australia, or maybe less so these days. So it kind of hits us, but I'm glad we still have the opportunities, and we hope that we can continue to keep meeting new students and making up new classes as long as the centre is closed.
Yeah. And girls, what about you? How's life been and schooling online? And
yeah, the girls have been doing their schooling online, so they've switched to online learning, and we are actually going to continue that. Their school won't reopen until August, when the new school year starts here. So they've lost probably almost half the school year, really. Half the year they'll be home, which was the same last year because we were back on furlough, so they spent 6 months at home last year, and they'll be doing the same again this year. So far that's been going okay. I guess it's the same for everyone. It's difficult because it's new, and just an adjustment. They miss their friends, and so we will head back to Chiang Mai, and then once we're up there, we'll be able to drop into the school and pick up books and resources and stuff like that for the next quarter. But for now, we're just doing what the school sends through each day on the computer, and they have a lot of Skype calls with their teachers and producers. So we've been probably doing, on Friday, I think we had 6 back-to-back Zoom calls. So I think everyone's probably never going to want to Zoom again once this is all over.
Yeah. Now, for people at church who you send out your monthly prayer points, updates. If people aren't receiving those and would like to, there's opportunities for people to support financially as well. Is the best way just that they get in contact with me, with the church, and then we can pass on details, or I think can get them more information. So
yeah.
If you wanted to be supporting, finding out more about the ministry and the mission going on that the Tingles are doing, do let me know. That would be great. Now we're going to pray and read the Bible. So Matt, you're going to kick off in prayer. I can keep doing that, and then we'll go to the Bible reading.
Okay, sure. Sounds good. Yeah. Lord God, we come to you now. We know that you are the one that we need today and every day. We need you, God. We need you to be with us. We need you to encourage us. We need you to help us, God. As we consider the world and everything that's happening in the world at this time, we know, God, that there are a lot of people that are feeling afraid, a lot of people that are feeling lonely and cut off, people that are struggling. We pray for those who have been directly affected by the coronavirus, having maybe had the virus or know people or have loved ones or even lost loved ones. Lord, we pray that they would know you as their comfort. We pray for your church to surround people at this time as they can. We pray for us, your people, to be creative, to take the initiative, to reach out to people in new ways and connect with people to be able to share of the hope that we have and to be able to point people to you. Lord God, we just want to pray for wisdom for world leaders at this time, other people that are involved with research and working on things, and other people that are looking at ways to logistically help in a situation. There's so many things that people are doing and providing for in this situation. Protect them, Lord God. And we pray for the world leaders and those on the local level making decisions, that you would give them your wisdom, God, help them to do what will be best for the people. Lord, we also just pray for those that may have lost employment or opportunities for employment, those that are in need financially, those that are in need just of the day-to-day things. We think of those in our community here, those in the community in Stanhope and other parts of the world, God. You know each person, you know their name, you know their needs, and we turn to you, God. We pray also, Lord, that this would be a time where people who not normally have an interest or have the time or ignoring you, God, that this would be a time where they have a time of waking up, a time of seeing what is true and what is real, and that they would see you, that they would turn to you, that they would call out to you, God, for help. We pray that this would be a time of awakening, a time of revival, God. We pray that we would see good coming from this and through this, and whatever situation we face, God, each day, that we would rely on you, the all-sufficient one. We thank you and pray these things in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
And Heavenly Father, I pray for Matt and Elisa, for Maya, Lucy and Jemima. Thank you that they can be there serving you in Thailand. I ask that they will keep trusting you, that you will keep providing all their needs and give them great opportunities with the people around them to be sharing Christ and their life. Help them at this time with all the changes that they can, keep looking to you. And we pray for the nation of Thailand. We pray that you would shine your light into that place. You would have pour out your mercy upon those people. By your Holy Spirit, bring many, many of them to faith in Christ. Father, thank you for your word. And as we look at it now, we ask that you will give us understanding and that you will help us to keep looking to you, keep looking to Christ every day. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so you're going to read for us from Hebrews 11.
Okay.
Now faith is confident in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commanded for. By faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings, and by faith, Abel still speaks even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen in holy fear, built an ark to save his family, but his faith is condemned. He condemned the world and became here for the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to the place that he would later receive as he inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundation. Those who are architect and builder is God. And by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was unable to bear children because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. And so from this one man, and he as good as dead, came descendant as numerous as the stars in the sky and as countless as the sand on the seashore. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance, admitting that they were foreigners and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had an opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them.
All right. Thank you very much. Well done, Jemima. Any final things that you want to say before we say goodbye to you for now?
Yeah. Well, thank you guys for the way that you're supporting us and encouraging us and praying for us. We really value that. And yeah, we're really excited for you guys. When we saw the picture of the building there and things like that, that's an exciting time for you guys as a church. And we're excited for you and pray that soon you'll be able to meet there together. But also during this time of preparation and time, I guess it's a time of waiting, that this would also be a valuable time for you as a church family. And just we want to continue to pray for you guys to keep growing in the Lord, relying on him at all times. And thank you for the relationship that we can share together, I guess in a distance, but at the same time we have the same God and Father. And so we're really grateful for that.
Yep, absolutely. All right, well, thank you. Thanks for sharing with us. And love our partnering together. All right, thank you.
Thanks a lot.
See ya. See ya. Okay, that's good to see those guys. If you got Hebrews 11 open, that would be great. This is known as the great chapter of faith, like a hall of fame, heroes of faith. Starts with Abel and goes through to Rahab. So it's largely focused on the first five books of the Bible, Israel's history there. Although it then does mention later on four judges, a king, Samuel and the prophets, and a few others. Now, the question that I want to ask this morning is why? Why has the writer written this? Why has he included all these people of faith, one after the other? Now, there are two verses that I think are helpful that we looked at last week to help us understand this. So the first is there in chapter 10, verse 36, where it says, "You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised." And then verse 39, "But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved." Or more literally there, it's those who have faith that persevere, that preserve the soul, faith that preserves the soul. So persevere in faith in order to preserve the soul, in order to receive the something better to come, which is ultimately God's eternal inheritance. Now, there's no sport at the moment, although I find it a little bit funny. Whenever I watch the news, there's still a sport report. There's no sport, and there hasn't been for weeks. Now, so just imagine that Wimbledon was on, and it's the final, and Ash Barty makes her way onto centre court. And as she walks up through the tunnel, on either side of her are past champions, people like Billie Jean King, Margaret Court, Yvonne Gulligong, Martina Navratilova, Steffi Graf, Venus Williams, Serena Williams. Now, why are they there? Why are they there? What purpose do they serve for Ash? Well, hopefully she makes her way onto centre court. They're going to inspire her. They're going to motivate her to play the best of her, the tennis that she can, so that she can be like them and be a champion as well, winning Wimbledon. She's got these people there cheering her on. Now, in Hebrews 6:12, we read this. "We do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who through faith and patience inherit what has been promised." And so we live now. We live now, and it's like we have these pictures on either side of us, people who have persevered in the faith, have preserved their soul, and it's like they are cheering us on to keep going, to keep trusting God. As 12:1 says, we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. So chapter 11 starts, verse 1, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." So I want to make three quick points about living by faith, trusting God, that will preserve the soul, a faith that preserves the soul. So firstly, we see it is acting on God's word to us, no matter what, acting on God's word. So take Noah, have a look at Noah there in verse 7. It says, "By faith Noah, when warned about the things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith." Now, can you just imagine what it was like for Noah to act on God's word? All right, you're told to build this massive ark, right? Massive ark. You're told there's going to be a flood and everything is going to be destroyed. But if you do what God says, then you and your family will be saved. Your life will be preserved. Now, just imagine the faith involved to act on that, to do that. And we don't know exactly where Noah was when he was told this, but I'm picturing him in the desert, in the wilderness, right? A dry place. Yet he is told to build this massive boat. And he did what God said. He did it. He could have shrunk back. He could have said no. He could have laughed it off, that there's no rain to be seen. Yet he did it, warned about the things not yet seen. In holy fear, he built the ark to save his family. He did what God said. Take Abraham. Abraham, he's told to leave his family. He's told to go to this land, this place unknown to him. Verse 8 says, by faith, when called to go, he obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. Right? That is trust. He did what God said. He's told he's going to be a great nation. But just imagine how that would have sounded to him and Sarah. Right, they're old, they don't have any children. How are they going to be a great nation? And then when God does deliver on that promise that gives them a son, what's Abraham then told to do? Sacrifice that son. Sacrifice Isaac. Now, Abraham knows that God's promises were going to come to bear through Isaac. So this is crazy, right? This is going to be messing with his mind. But he was prepared to do what God said. He acted on God's word because he reasoned that God could raise the dead. Now that is faith. That is acting on God's word no matter what. This is like what we said last week. To trust is also to obey. To have faith is to act on what we say that we believe. Noah, Abraham, others in this chapter, they can inspire us to keep going, to keep believing God's word, to keep acting on God's word, being people of obedience, no matter what the cost. No matter what it is that God says, we can trust him. Now, this is faith that preserves the soul. So that's the first thing. But secondly, it's looking ahead to something better to come. Might not see it now, but know that it is coming. Because God is good, God is faithful, he is true to his word. So, like we see it back in verse 1, when it talks about faith in the context of this chapter. Faith is confidence or assurance of what we hope for. That is what is to come, what we do not see. So we see it for Abraham in verse 10. And it says there, he was looking forward to the city with foundations, who architect and builder is God. And then verse 16. Instead, they, so Abraham and the others along with him, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. So they did have some immediate fulfillments, like they did get the land, Abraham was given the son, but there was something better to come. Spoken about here is this heavenly city where God would dwell with his people. So looking ahead to something better to come. We see it with Moses as well. Have a look, verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he'd grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. Now, there is so much in there, so much in those verses. Moses, he had so much. He was married to Pharaoh's daughter, but he sees having faith in God, that is better. There is more to come. And so any enjoyment from being unfaithful to God, that is fleeting. He's looking ahead to something better. Verse 26 there even mentions Christ. If you keep reading down verse 34, 35 and onwards, there it speaks of people who were suffering, suffered greatly, but persevered in their faith. Looking ahead, it says, to an even better resurrection. That's why they did it, looking ahead to something better to come. Suffering now, but glory to come. And so they were able to keep living by faith, acting on God's word, looking ahead to something better to come. Now, none of these people of faith fully received what was promised. Have a look how the writer finishes this chapter down in 39 and 40. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Now, this is where we see the something better to come is Christ and the new covenant. And for them, it was ahead. But for us, living this side of the cross, we have it now. We have Christ now. And so the third and final point about living by faith is it is fixing our eyes on Jesus. The start of chapter 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So we are to fix our eyes on Jesus, on the one that we put our faith in. He is the one who makes us perfect, even though we are not. We are sinful. You are sinful. We're all sinful. And if it was not for Christ, we could never relate with God. It is only because of Christ and what he has done for us that we can come to God. And so our faith is in Christ. It's not our faith that saves us. It is what our faith is in. Our faith is in Christ, and Christ is the one who saves us. And in all of this hall of faith, if you like, the ultimate example of faith is Christ himself. He is the one who in faith was able to do what his heavenly Father required him to do. And obediently, he went to the cross. He endured the cross. And he did that for us. He did that for his Father, that we could be brought back into relationship with him. Jesus dies on the cross. He takes your sin. He takes my sin upon himself. And so we are to fix our eyes on Jesus. fix our eyes on him. That is faith that preserves the soul. And so we have all these people of faith cheering us on, as it were, encouraging us to keep going each day, to keep being people of faith, to keep looking to Jesus every single day. Persevere right to the end. So as we finish looking at this part of God's word, let me ask you, with COVID-19, what is that doing to your faith in Christ? Right now, these last few weeks, however you've been affected by COVID-19, what is that doing to your faith in Christ? Now, I know for some of you, it is making you stronger in faith as you look to God, as you seek the Lord, trust him more, coming to him in prayer. I know for many of you, that has been one of the really good things about this, seeing that we're not in control, but he is, and so we depend on him, we trust him. In all this uncertainty, you see that he is your rock, he is your constant in all of this, and we can trust him. For others, though, maybe you are shrinking back, or maybe you see no difference to your faith at all. That would be a great shame. My hope, my prayer for you, for every single one of us at this time, is that we will come through this stronger in faith, that every single one of us will be trusting Christ, acting on God's word, looking ahead to what is to come with our eyes fixed on Jesus. May that be true for you. May that be true for you tomorrow, the next day, all of this week, next week as well. May we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, keep trusting him, persevere. That is faith that preserves the soul. We're going to sing of Jesus, the great King of Kings, who makes all of this possible for us. We're going to return to the house of the Simmons, so please do sing along with them. Let's rejoice in Jesus. Thank you.
heaven held its breath till that storm was moved for good. For the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tomb, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls were born to come to the Father on His throne, and the Church of Christ was born, and the Spirit in the flames. Now the gospel truth of all shall not yield, shall not faint, by His blood and in His name.
Praise forever to the King of Kings, indeed. So pleased that you've been able to join with us today. And hopefully you have been encouraged in faith to keep going, to keep trusting Jesus. As we mentioned before, there's a few opportunities to be getting involved in different things. Love you to do at least one of these. Thursday night, find out more about preparing to move in. We've got the Bible reading plan, so maybe you want to take action on that one. 60 days reading through Paul's letters. Check that one out. And then Christianity Explored. Maybe that's the one for you. Do let us know if you need more details about any of those, or if you are interested, that would be fantastic. In a moment, we will have our morning tea, so I invite you to take part in that as well. The details for that will be there in the chat. They're on the Facebook as well. Let me finish with these words. Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory with great joy, to the only God our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion and authority before all time, and now and forevermore. Amen.